First of all, I want to welcome you to this event on ITA expansion. I'm Rob Atkinson, I'm president of ITIF, and we're releasing a new report this morning that estimates the U.S. and also global benefits of expanding the ITA agreement, and my colleague Stephen Azell will walk through those findings. Let me start by introducing folks from my my left to right. Stephen Azell is the senior analyst at ITIF who focuses on principally on innovation policy, competitiveness, and manufacturing services issues. He's also the co-author. At every event we do from now on, between now and September, we're going to have to mention the fact that we have a book coming out, and Stephen and I are co-author of a book by Yale Press called Innovation Economics, The Race for Global Advantage. Greg Slater is the Director of Trade and Competition Policy at Intel Corporation, where he provides legal and policy advice on emerging laws and regulations. He's also responsible for all of government agreements relating to Intel's factory investments worldwide. Prior to joining Intel in 97, Greg was in private practice at Steptoe and Johnson and then at Latham and Watkins in D.C., and he began his law career as a clerk for former Chief Judge Albert Engel on the U.S. Sixth Circuit. And he graduated from the J. Reuben Clark School, Law School at Brigham Young University. Sue Schwab is the Professor of Public Policy at University of Maryland and a strategic advisor at the law firm of Mayer Brown. Ambassador Schwab served as U.S. Trade Representative from 2006 to 2009. And she was Deputy U.S. Trade Rep from 2005 and 2006. And in that capacity, she played a central role in defending the integrity of the ITA as it was being implemented globally. Previously, she has served as the Dean of the School of Public Policy at University of Maryland, President of the University System of Maryland Foundation, and in the private sector was Director of Corporate Business Development for Motorola, where she negotiated JV agreements in China and elsewhere in Asia. In government, Ambassador Schwab also served as Assistant Secretary of Commerce and Director General of the U.S. And Foreign Commercial Service. Prior to that, she was Legislative Director of Senator John Danforth and has a PhD from George Washington University. And I'm not in order here. There we go. Charlene Barshefsky is the Senior International Partner at WilmerHale. She joined the firm after serving as a United States Trade Representative from 1997 to 2001, and she was acting and deputy trade rep from 93 to 96. She's best known internationally as the architect and chief negotiator of China's historic WTO agreement, as well as global agreements in financial services, IP rights, and cyberspace. And importantly for this event, she was played a critical role in launching the ITA agreement in 1996. She has a 25-year legal career in the field, including international litigation, commercial negotiations, and regulatory advice. And last is who I'll introduce, and she should be here just really any minute, Ambassador Miriam Shapiro, who is Deputy United States Trade Representative, where she is responsible for trade negotiations and enforcement with Europe, the Middle East, and the Americas. She also supervises services and investment, and she's here in small business, market access, industrial competitiveness, intellectual property and innovation, and the Washington, D.C. Office of WTO. Ambassador, thank you for joining us. Great to see you. We're just getting started.
That was my cue.
I can start over on your bio, but I don't think
I've heard it before.
Ambassador Shapiro was also the founder and president of Summit Strategies International, a consulting firm specializing in internet telecom policy from 2002 to 2008. She has served as chairman of the Coalition of Services Industries China E-Commerce Committee and vice president of the American Society of International Law. She's also a member of the Secretary of State's policy planning staff and worked in the Office of Legal Advisor and a number of other distinguished positions and awards. She received her JD from the New York University School of Law and has taught international law at NYU, Georgetown, and Columbia. So with that, let me just make a few framing remarks. The report we're issuing today suggests that nations and the global economy can harvest very significant benefits through tariff elimination on ICT products, and we can get even more benefits by expanding the product coverage. And with the Doha dead or dormant, these kind of sectoral agreements will play an increasing role in moving forward on the path of trade liberalization. But I would argue that ITA is important for really more than that, because to me it represents solutions to two big problems that are, I think, at the core of the global trading system. Those two problems really are first, nations erect an array of barriers to natural job creation and full employment. And there's no real reason why, absent not being in a recession, every country in the world should have full employment. The only reason they don't is because they have inherent barriers that have been established in a country that make that difficult to do it. So countries have these barriers, and then as a way to then again get full employment, rather than eliminate these barriers, they think it's easier if we can just get a computer company to come in and open up a factory and create a few hundred jobs. So they're sort of, if you will, compensating for a whole set of mistakes by making another set of mistakes. And as we showed in a report we issued last week, where Ambassador Shapiro's counterpart, Demetrius Marantzis, was here, the Global Innovation Policy Index, we document which countries really are getting it right in the world on these kinds of policies and which are not. But the second big problem is that countries then say, well, we can't get full employment, so we're going to do these kinds of policies like tariffs, import substitution, export equivalency as a way to drive job growth. And they actually see that as the path to prosperity. And the evidence is pretty overwhelming. That is absolutely not the path to prosperity. If you look, for example, at China has a set of policies, including some of these restrictions on what they call strategic and emerging industries. And they're going to invest the equivalent of 5 stimulus packages a year for 5 years to build these strategic industries. And if they meet their goals by 2020, which they absolutely will not meet their goals, but in my opinion, even if they were to meet their goals, they'd get 14 months of economic growth out of that. India is the same way. They put tariffs on imported computers as a way to get the computer sector. But for every dollar that they get on tariffs, they lose $1.30 in economic growth. But as they say, they make it up on volume. So that's really, to me, why the ITA is so important, because it really says what we have to focus on here is about a set of policies that are enabling the broad-scale use of ICT around the globe, whether it's for low-income people to access the internet, small businesses to be able to be just as competitive as big businesses or big companies and governments. And if we can do that, that's really how we're going to drive global prosperity. So with that, I'm going to turn over to my colleague Stephen Azell, who will just quickly give an overview of our report findings, and then we'll hear from Ambassador Shapiro.
All right. Good morning. Next slide, Alexis, please. Great, thank you. So I imagine everyone is familiar with the Information Technology Agreement, or you would not be here this morning. Still, allow me to give a brief overview. The agreement removes tariffs on hundreds of ICT products. When it was launched in 1996, it covered 8 core categories of tariff elimination on products such as computers, semiconductors, and telecommunications equipment. Since 1996, the agreement has grown from 29 initial members to 73 today. The ITA eliminates tariffs on $4 trillion of two-way trade in ICT products. Yet, the product coverage of the ITA has not been updated since the agreement's launch in 1996, despite the fact that since then, a vast array of new information and communications products, everything from global positioning satellite GPS systems to video game console systems like Microsoft PlayStation or Sony's Xbox, remote home and health monitoring systems. A whole generation of new innovative information technology products are not covered by the agreement, as well as an entirely new class of next-generation semiconductor products called MCOs, or multi-component semiconductors. All these products, we argue, should be brought under the ITA. In addition to the new products that have been launched since 1996, even at the time, the initial ITA did not cover a number of everyday computer electronic products, such as video games, DVD players, and audio speakers. Therefore, ITIF argues that we should expand the product coverage of the Information Technology Agreement substantially. Why should we do so? Well, for four key reasons. First, it will benefit the United States. But secondly, it will benefit developing countries as well. Moreover, it will benefit the entire broader global economy. And it will continue to carry momentum forward for multilateral global trade liberalization, especially, as Rob pointed out, at a time when it's very important to keep that momentum going. So if the ITA agreement is expanded, as proposed by U.S. industry, it would bring an additional $800 billion in two-way trade in ICT products under ITA coverage. This would include an additional $40.6 billion worth of U.S. exports of ICT products. So what we do in the paper is we point out that not only will the number or the volume of products that the U.S. exports increase and come under ITA coverage, but we point out that the reduction of tariffs that ITA expansion brings will foster increased global demand for ICT products. So if you look globally, the average tariff on non-ITA covered ICT products is 5.3%. But U.S. firms actually face much higher tariffs in a number of areas. If you look at the tariffs imposed on exports of video game console systems, you see that they're 15% in Indonesia, 20% in Thailand, 23% in Vietnam. So if we bring such products into the ITA, global tariffs on them will come down quite substantially. So essentially what you do is you look at the decrease in tariffs, and you can use numbers from the World Bank that look at what are called import demand elasticities. This is the increase in demand for a product that will occur given a certain reduction of price. So when you apply those numbers, as we do in the report, what we found is that if ITA is expanded, as proposed by U.S. industry, it would boost U.S. exports by $2.8 billion. It would lead to an increase in the revenues of U.S. ICT firms by $10 billion, and it would support the creation of a total of 60,000 direct, indirect, and induced new U.S. jobs in the United States. Moreover, of course, IT expansion would benefit users, both consumers and businesses, of ICT products and services in the United States. Now, despite the fact that U.S. tariffs on these products are actually pretty low, about 2% in a basket of 20 products, I looked at, still consumers will benefit from the price reductions. But I think as importantly as how much the ITA would benefit the United States, it would also substantially benefit developing countries. And it would do so for three reasons. First off, because lower cost of ICTs spurs diffusion and adoption of key technologies that are absolutely vital to growth in developing countries. In fact, the World Bank finds that just a 10% increase in mobile phone penetration in developing countries raises their annual per capita GDP by 0.81%. Likewise, a 10% increase in broadband internet penetration in developing countries increases their annual per capita GDP by 1.38%. Those are substantial gains for developing countries. Also, as Rob pointed out, lower cost of ICTs makes all other industries in a developing economy, or a developed one for that matter, more competitive. So Rob pointed out the study by Kaushik and Singh that looked at the Indian economy before it joined the ITA in 1997 and found that for every dollar of tariffs India placed on ICT products, it suffered a $1.30 loss throughout the rest of its economy due to lower productivity in industries such as airlines, transportation, banking. So high tariffs on a critical general purpose technology like ICT only damages economic growth prospects in the rest of the broader economy. And the third reason I think ITA's expansion is important for developing countries is because affordable, best-of-breed ICT products undergird development of ICT software and services industries. And we actually see that pretty clearly. First, with regard to ICT goods exports, if we look at the percentage within a country that ICT goods exports account for out of their total goods exports, what's astounding is how much higher it is in ITA member versus non-ITA member countries. In fact, in the Philippines and Malaysia, ICT goods account for 54 and 38% respectively of those countries' total goods exports. Clearly, in the non-ITA countries like Brazil, Argentina, and Chile, it's just a fraction. But what's even more astounding is if you look at the trend lines, this shows 2009, but if you look at the trend lines between 1997 and 2009, in the growth of ICT goods exports as a share of the economy's total goods exports, you see that from 97 to 2009, ICT goods exports increased by 93% in the Philippines and by 59% in India, while it declined by 49% in Argentina and 26% in Brazil. As I noted, we see the exact same trends with ICT software and services exports. So here, if we look at the change in ICT services exports as a percentage of the country's services exports from 1996 to 2010, what you see is over 50% growth in countries like Malaysia, China, and the Philippines, but substantial decreases in countries like Brazil and Chile, where ICT services exports as a share of their services exports in total have declined by over 150%. Those are really astounding numbers, I think. And for me, at least, what they show is that for countries that wish to spur domestic ICT industries, the way to do so is becoming an ITA member, not by erecting barriers for trade such as high tariffs. Finally, we find that ITA expansion will benefit the broader global economy. Recent research from Harvard's Kennedy School of Government finds that a 10% increase in the ICT capital stock of an economy or a country boosts that economy's output growth by 0.45%. Now, if we apply the same methodology to look at the increased demand for ICT products that will occur globally through tariff reduction, we find that IT expansion will increase global GDP by $190 billion a year. So, in summary, we feel that the ITA has been one of the world's most successful trade agreements over the past 15 years. The ITA has worked very well, but the ITA can work even better if it is updated to accommodate and include the vast array of new innovative information technology products that have been created over the past 15 years. In truth, the ITA has been a real win-win trade agreement for developing and developed countries alike, for consumers and producers alike. If the ITA is expanded, it will continue to drive innovation, to boost productivity, to increase exports, to accelerate economic growth, and to produce prosperity for peoples all over the world. We strongly feel that ITA product coverage expansion should be a key goal of both the US and global trade policy community in the coming year. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Sebastian, do you want to come here or there?
Yeah, up here.
Yeah.
See me that way.
Yep.
I just saw if you were sitting down. Everyone hear me? Good morning. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. I'm so delighted, especially to be with two former U.S. trade representatives for whom I have the greatest admiration. I have to say, I'm really pleased, Rob, not only did you organize this terrific event, but you put me first because they would be a very, very tough act to follow. You've done a terrific job, you and Steve, in laying out the reasons why this is such an important initiative and for hosting this event today. I want to congratulate both of you and all of the ITIF staff for this tremendous report on boosting exports, jobs, and growth. three terms I like to hear, and I can't hear often enough. Of course, doing this by expanding the ITA. I think the report, and if you haven't had a chance to look at it, I urge each of you to do so. I think the report does a really good job of explaining the success of the ITA to date and what are the many benefits of extending duty-free treatment to a greater number of ICT products. This is very valuable and very timely input as we work now to advance all aspects of our 2012 trade agenda, including expanding this important agreement. It's truly an honor to be here on this panel and have a chance to have a discussion with not one, but two former USTRs, one of whom was instrumental in shaping and concluding the ITA, and the other who helped ensure the integrity of the agreement. Ambassador Charlene Barshefsky was one of the original architects, as many of you know, back in 1996, the last century. And she... But here's the nice part. She negotiated what was probably...
And she still breathes.
She negotiated what was probably the first 21st century agreement. So it's a phrase we throw around a lot right now, but Charlene had the foresight to do it way back then, all of 15 years ago. It wasn't really that long ago. We're just teasing each other. Ambassador Susan Schwab worked to ensure that all the participants in this 21st century agreement lived up to their ITA obligations by upholding the principle that changes in technology are not an excuse to apply new duties to products that are covered by the ITA. As trade representative, she initiated the successful WTO dispute against the European Union for charging duties on certain ITA products that they should not have been doing. This was a very important victory that we then won in August of 2010, and it has helped pave the way for today's discussion. If anything, I'd like you to take away from my remarks today three important points. First, the ITA has been more successful than any of us could have imagined. Second, the Obama administration is working hard to build support for expanding both ITA coverage and ITA membership. And lastly, expansion can have, and I believe will have, a significant impact on U.S. and global economic growth, including by sustaining and creating jobs. In terms of achievements, I know everyone in this room is aware that this has been one of the most successful agreements ever undertaken in the multilateral trading system. Steve and Rob laid out the reasons why. In the 15 years since the agreement entered into force, global trade in ICT products has more than tripled, currently $4 billion annually. The spectacular growth has been in no part driven by the increase in the number of participants from 28 countries and territories to 73 today. Last year, the United States overall exported more than $2 trillion, which was up 33% from 2009. Our participation, I believe, in the ITA contributed to that increase and is helping us to meet the president's goal of doubling exports by the end of 2014. At the present time, we are ahead of schedule and on pace to exceed that goal. I'm very pleased, therefore, to be here to have this chance to talk to you about how we can build on the success of the last 15 years by expanding the duty-free product scope. It's timely as we approach the anniversary, the 15th year anniversary, the end of this month. It's timely, I think, to take a fresh look at how we can go about building the support we need to expand its benefits. Last fall, when the United States chaired APEC, we proposed, and other leaders agreed, that APEC economies would work together to advance negotiations to expand the ITA's product coverage and membership. In terms of expanding membership, we are already making progress. Last year, we secured a commitment from Russia to join the ITA as part of its accession to the WTO. Russia, by the way, is getting ready to enter the WTO not later than this summer under the terms of its accession protocol. If Congress has not yet succeeded in terminating the Jackson-Vanik Amendment that bars PNTR, permanent normal trade relations, for Russia, then U.S. exporters and workers will be unable to enjoy the rights and benefits that we negotiated. We call on Congress to work with us now to avoid such an outcome. In addition to Russia, Colombia is currently in the process of joining the ITA as a result of its commitment to do so as part of the U.S.-Colombia Free Trade Agreement. I would note that today is a very big day in the trade world because we are bringing into force our trade agreement with Korea, and we are working to bring our agreements with Colombia and Panama also into force as soon as possible. We're also working to build an ITA commitment into the Trans-Pacific Partnership negotiations now underway. At the most recent negotiating round in Melbourne, the United States tabled proposed language to enshrine the ITA and participation in the agreement as a market access commitment for all current and future TPP partners. As we work now to lay the groundwork to launch new negotiations to expand the ITA, we need to make sure that we get it right. Our immediate focus at USTR and in our discussions with key ITA partners is to lay the groundwork for a successful conclusion. Given the well-known challenges in recent years of advancing trade liberalization in the WTO, we are collaborating closely with like-minded ITA members in numerous venues to shape a viable negotiating approach. Our challenge is to define the scope of the negotiations in a way that can bring all ITA participants to the table and at the same time deliver a commercially meaningful result in the near term, not light years from now. Our industry stakeholders are playing a critical role in this effort to frame the ITA negotiations for success. They are actively engaging foreign industry counterparts and promoting the benefits of ITA expansion directly to ITA member governments. Industry's message, conveyed from the highest levels, has been clear and very welcome. Governments should place a top priority on eliminating tariffs on more ICT products, and our negotiating efforts should be focused on an ambitious outcome that can provide immediate results. The mandate from APEC leaders places a clear priority on expanding ITA product coverage. This instruction is consistent with the ITA ministerial declaration itself, which directs ITA participants to review the product coverage with a view to agreeing by consensus whether, in light of technological developments, experience in applying the tariff concessions, or changes to the HS nomenclature, the attachments should be modified to incorporate additional products. We have the mandate. The benefits of tariff elimination under the ITA have been widespread and very well documented, I think, in the ITA, in their ITIF report on the ITA. And it extends beyond the ICT sector itself. Expanding the scope of product coverage will multiply these benefits by further driving innovation and enhancing productivity across industries, and thereby continuing to raise living standards around the world. U.S. companies are the world's largest producers of ICT products. As such, it is hard to overstate the importance of the ICT industry to the U.S. economy. For instance, U.S. semiconductors maintain over two-thirds of their manufacturing capacity in the United States, supporting millions of high-paying U.S. technology jobs. And in each of the last 5 years, the United States exported more semiconductors than any other product, including automobiles. As the ITIF's report makes very clear, the benefits of a successful ITA negotiation for the United States would be significant. Annual ICT exports would increase by almost $3 billion, supporting approximately 60,000 jobs. The benefits of ITA expansion are also clear for developing countries. Over the last 15 years, developing countries have moved up the value chain in electronics manufacturing and emerged as major players in ICT production and exports. Between 1996 and 2008, developing country ITA exports expanded at an annual growth rate of nearly 34%, compared to just over 7% for developed countries. That's four times as fast. What I found particularly interesting in the ITIF report is the fact that as much as 80% of the economic benefits from technology derive from ICT usage, while only 20% is attributed to actual production. Simply increasing the number of internet users has been shown to improve export performance in developing countries. However, charging tariffs on ICT products imposes unnecessary costs on consumers and on industrial producers. This in turn can discourage ITC usage and forestall the benefits of ICT diffusion throughout the economy. Restricting trade and limiting access to new technologies, in our view, only stifles innovation, limits improvements in productivity, and ultimately slows economic development. We know that it can be tempting to use high tariff policies to promote domestic manufacturing. But what countries may not realize is that they are actually creating a negative ripple effect throughout regional and global production chains. Duties charged on inputs at each step of the production chain drive up the prices on the final product. Charging tariffs on semiconductors, for example, disadvantages manufacturers who integrate these vital components into a wide variety of products, including automobiles and refrigerators, to name just a few. In this way, high tariffs actually discourage companies from investing in the countries that charge them and ultimately make these economies less competitive in the global marketplace. As such, we should not underestimate the significant commercial benefits of eliminating tariffs on more ICT goods by expanding ITA product coverage. As successful as the ITA has been over the last 15 years, the ICT sector has evolved significantly. There are many new technologies and innovations that have entered the marketplace since 1996 and that are not covered by the ITA. These products include Bluetooth devices, GPS systems, smart meters, and even some specialized semiconductors, to name just a few. In addition, the current ITA product scope does not even include many consumer electronic products that were in existence at the time the ITA was negotiated, including televisions, video players, and video game consoles. I know, it's hard to believe. Today's consumer has increasing flexibility to access digital content from these and other devices and platforms. New generation audiovisual products are much more sophisticated than their predecessors, incorporating new features and technologies, connecting directly to networks, interacting with computers, and accessing and creating digital content. Yet televisions and video players still face 14% duties in Europe and rates as high as 20 to 30% in certain Asian markets. The ongoing ITA negotiators, the original ITA negotiators also recognized that changes to the HS, the Harmonized System, tariff nomenclature would be another important reason to expand ITA product coverage. And indeed, the HS nomenclature has been changed in 2002, 2007, and again in 2012. This has contributed to uncertainty with respect to customs classification for numerous electronic products. It is clear that a comprehensive expansion of ITA product coverage could therefore effectively reduce costs to businesses and consumers, as well as administrative challenges for customs officials due to the classification uncertainty. In conclusion, for all of these reasons, advances in the ICT industry, bringing new products to market, increasing connectivity of consumer electronics devices, and changes to the tariff classification nomenclature lead me to conclude that the time for ITA members to negotiate an expansion to the ITA is right, but we have to frame it properly. The United States will continue working collaboratively with like-minded trading partners bilaterally at the upcoming APEC meetings and at the WTO to build strong support for this initiative and multilateral cooperation. Again, I would like to thank ITIF for issuing its report and for organizing this discussion. I am also deeply grateful to the private sector for promoting the benefits of ITA expansion. I am confident that if we frame this initiative in the right way and place top priority on expanding product coverage, we can achieve the consensus we need to deliver an ambitious and commercially meaningful outcome for our companies, our workers, and our consumers. This is good for America, and it's good for our trading partners, both developed and developing around the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Shapiro and Ambassador Barshefsky.
since there'll be three ambassadors in the row, I dub you all ambassadors. So, Rob and Steve, thank you very much. The report's a terrific piece of work. John Newfer, thank you very, very much. And Joe Tasker, who I had not seen in a long time, thank you for a terrific product list for extension. I'm going to call it the Tasker list. It's terrific to be here with you all. What I thought I would do, since I think we're probably all preaching to the choir, is to talk a little bit about the original vision behind the ITA, a little bit how we put it together, which has resonance today, how it's operated, which I think we all agree has been very good, and why it has to be expanded. And there's no excuse not to expand it, and not to expand it now. This should take 1 year. Shouldn't take any longer than a year to do this. So in the 90s, the Clinton administration recognized the absolute importance of innovation and technology to drive the economy. And we pursued a very broad range of tech-friendly policies during the 90s, which have resonance and importance even today. In the trade area, we looked at ways to spur the digital economy and to promote the growth of the internet, because even then, we knew that internet growth would be central to our economic growth and global economic growth. This was already clear 15, 16, 17 years ago. And so we focused on three key sectors that we thought would be most important from the trade perspective. One was e-commerce, one was telecommunications, and one was hardware for the digital economy. Those were the big three. And so out of these three locuses came three separate international agreements. One on duty-free cyberspace, which was a commitment on the part of all countries not to impose duties on internet transactions. And this has been absolutely critical to the growth of e-commerce. Second, the basic telecom agreement, where we negotiated a WTO agreement to remove barriers across global telecom markets, vastly reduce costs, and therefore the incentive for connectivity, which was absolutely critical, right? And third, the ITA. All three of these agreements have held up very well. I'd like to see the Global Telecom Agreement updated. It needs an update, as do some other agreements. But all of these have really held up very, very well. And I think ITA was really a keystone agreement, because free trade in IT hardware accelerates the growth of the telecom sector, connectivity, the entire digital economy. And because IT goods are inputs into every manufacturing and non-tech industry, and I mean every, IT also drives growth economy-wide. So that was the vision in the early and mid-90s, and it was absolutely the right vision. In terms of substance, the goal for the ITA was the complete elimination of tariffs, zero. Not 2%, not 5%, not cut it in half, zero, 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 zero. Makes it easy, everyone understands zero. You know what it means when it's zero. There's no ambiguity in zero. And that would be on all of the goods covered by the agreement at the time. Now, there are two main challenges when we put the ITA together. So the first is the challenge of free riding. The conception behind the agreement was to zero out tariffs on a non-discriminatory MFN basis, meaning not everybody has to be in the room. If you're going to do a deal, and it's only among some people, but it's an MFN deal, it's fine under WTO rules. The only objection WTO has to sectoral agreements is when they're non-MFN. So we wanted it to be MFN, everyone benefits, all WTO members, whether or not they signed. So what does that imply? Well, the problem with that approach is that you can have free riders, countries that sit back, let other people agree, slash their tariffs, do all of that, and because it's MFN, the guys who sat on the back bench get all the benefits. How do you avoid that? And so what we came up with was the concept of critical mass. If you have a critical mass of countries, which we defined as that group of countries that at the time represented about 90% of tech trade. If you have a critical mass of countries, it doesn't matter that everyone else is free riding. They're economically inconsequential anyway. And because if you're a major IT player, a refusal to sign would mean no critical mass, and therefore the agreement would not come into effect. You had to participate to get the benefit. You had to cut your tariffs to get the benefit. So all of the commercially significant players in the market over time stepped up to the plate. And the ITA agreement came into effect when we had the critical mass, which was when we hit 29 countries. We actually had it before 29, but that's okay. We started with 7 countries, which became 11, which became 16 or 17, 23, 29. 29, it goes into effect. And the fact that the other 160 countries got the benefits, who cares? They weren't consequential in the trade. So critical mass is also how we did the global telecom agreement. It's also how we did the global financial services agreement. It's also how we did duty-free cyberspace. They're all MFN agreements, but countries that aren't significant in the trade don't matter. And the advantage to that is countries don't hold up the talks. If Fiji wanted to free ride on the ITA agreement, go for it. What difference would it make? It is, I think, a continuing tragedy that global climate change talks never proceeded on the same basis. When you look at global polluters, of which the key are probably 10 countries, not 210. In any event, the second challenge for in putting the agreement together was how do you describe products you can't imagine? Typically, as was said, products go by these technical tariff categories, and they're very specific and picky. But tech doesn't work that way. Tech morphs. The innovation cycle, Moore's Law, is so fast. You don't know that what you're looking at today is going to be what you're looking at tomorrow, even if the functionality is relatively the same. And so we looked at ITA products not only by these tariff categories, but also we created what we called a positive list, which was a descriptive list. Network equipment, or computers, or integrated circuits. So that even if the technical tariff category changed, the product was still covered. And the importance of that is the products covered were zeroed out in terms of tariffs. Zero. Products not covered by the agreement retained their original tariff rate. So you wanted to be able to follow as much as you could that product all the way through in its various morphing states and still end up at a zero tariff. So these two features of the ITA, the critical mass and the positive list, meant that the ITA could fulfill its mission. And I think as Miriam said, that the vision and the execution have far surpassed what we had envisioned even in 96. And in 96, we gave some fairly forward-leaning estimates. We were wrong threefold in our forward-leaning estimates in terms of how positive the impact of the agreement would be. Just 2 more minutes. 1 more minute, actually. And as was already said, the ITA isn't just good for tech companies. It has a multiplier effect throughout the economy. Whether you're in high-end manufacturing, whether you're a freight company with very complex logistics, ITA mattered. And it mattered most of all for developing countries, because a developing country could finally participate in the global economy by having a share of the global supply chain located in their country. And how do you deconstruct a supply chain and make it global? IT. That's what allowed for the dispersion of what used to be unitary in-country supply chains. Developing countries were the key beneficiary of that change. And as you saw from the various statistics presented, those who participated in the ITA reaped enormous rewards. So the ITIF data, you're familiar with, and all of that. Now what happens? This group needs to be expanded. Miriam indicated some of the list of the products, GPS devices is another. There's lots of stuff not included in the ITA. It needs to be included. This is not hard to do. The mandate exists in the existing agreement. Everyone who operates in this space knows the agreement is now old relative to the technologies that are available today. And what you ultimately want is zero tariffs on all ICT products without exception. That's the goal. In my view, it should be achievable in a year's time. In a year's time, countries who are already in it know how beneficial it's been, and they know that an area is not covered by the agreement, they would only gain positively by coverage. So we need to get to it. Thank you.
Thank you. Ambassador Schwab.
We're getting to the point where everything's been said, but not everyone said it. Rod, thank you very much for this marvelous opportunity. Stephen, a great report. Thank you. A special thanks to a couple people here who, during my time as trade representative, made me look really smart, a lot smarter than I am. John Newfer, Jim Sanford, Steve Norton, thank you. Miriam, very much welcomed your commitment to making this happen. And Charlene, you know, big congratulations. This is really very much a tribute to your tenure as trade rep and the vision and the leadership and the negotiating prowess. I mean, you sort of tossed off the, well, critical mass in 29 countries, and it's not that easy, guys. Just sort of a hint. I'm gonna briefly put on the occasional academic hat that I have and just offer a couple of observations here. Why do countries engage in this kind of a trade agreement? You know, the economist in me will remind you all that we really should be doing all these things unilaterally, and your data tells us why, and the World Bank data tells us why countries really should be unilaterally eliminating their tariffs for ICT products and any import barriers they have for ICT products, services, software. That doesn't happen. Countries, for the most part, countries engage in trade agreements in part as an excuse to do things through trade agreements that they probably should do unilaterally in terms of economic reforms. Here is an ideal, I mean, just a sort of exhibit A. ICT tariff reductions generate economic growth. Look at page 9 of this report if you want any evidence if there was any question in your mind. Tariffs on ICT products are taxes on innovation and economic growth. Again, the report makes it very, very clear, regardless of country, developed or developing. And the only difference between countries are the ones that have figured this out and get the joke and the ones that haven't gotten the joke. A note on your free rider issue, I would quote Tim Keeler, my colleague at Mayor Brown, who was with me at USTR. Free riders on the ITA are the countries that are in the slowest cars on the highway. Seriously, you look at Brazil and Argentina, and you look at the competitiveness of manufacturing in those economies, and you think, who would want to emulate that? And there's a reason. And you just, you know, start looking at the fact that they are not members of the ITA. And they have effectively shot themselves in the foot. These are self-inflicted wounds. The lack of competitiveness, and it is sad but true. The May 2008 case, WTO case, that the Bush administration took against the European Union's effort to wriggle out of the redefine the ITA, what constituted coverage, product coverage. As Charlene noted, having the positive list, having those definitions there was instrumental. That really made a huge difference when you think about the evolution of technology. We could have gotten to a point where we had an ITA and it didn't cover any products whatsoever. Had we not been able to make that case, we were able to make that case, and now really is the point where we need to expand the coverage of this agreement. So, in fact, the information technology agreement is the past and it is the future, and it should be the future. The WTO is, I would argue, desperately in need of confidence-building measures. This should be...
Resuscitation.
I was trying to be a little kinder than that. But what a perfect opportunity to bring together, call it a critical mass, call it a coalition of the willing, call it a coalition of the smart and the willing, but bring together a group of countries that get it, that have figured out that they can help themselves by coming together to expand product coverage, to cover products that didn't exist before, to cover products that they missed the last time. And guess what? This is not a heavy lift in terms of going to Capitol Hill. The residual authority is there. In terms of implementing authority for our executive branch, this can be done in a timely fashion and be money and a boost to economic growth for all countries smart enough to avail themselves of this opportunity. So I would just say it's doable. Let's get it done.
Great.
That's it.
Well, wonderful. Thank you.
Greg.
I think we're beyond the point where everything's been said. Let me just give the industry viewpoint. We've heard the academic, the economist, the government viewpoint, and just make a couple of points from a semiconductor industry perspective and on a broader level from an ICT industry perspective. This chart's interesting. This is from the Boston Consulting Group's report in January, because what it indicates is the correlation between per capita GDP and an e-intensity measurement, which is the depth and reach of digital activity. So I can't remember which ambassadors talked about the three agreements. This ties the three agreements together, because it's not just the benefits of broadband, it's the benefits of tying broadband to all the digital devices. And if you lower the tariffs on all the internet, the digital devices, and so forth, you increase dissemination and you increase per capita GDP. So there's a nice correlation. Next slide. And this has already been the Alexis. This has already been talked about. 80% of the value of ICT is in the dissemination. So the IT producing industries contribute the most to the economy because of that factor. And certainly semiconductors is there. This is an eyesore, but basically says what's been said before. You lower the tariffs by 1%, you increase demand by 1.5%, you increase dissemination, you increase the spin-off benefits, you increase the profitability of ICT companies, who then reinvest that and produce more innovative products, which then increases productivity further. It's instead of a tax on innovation, you get this virtual cycle by lowering the costs of ICT. Now let me get to semiconductors real quick. This is from a Bloomberg report of last year. We play in at least three of these spaces. On the left, semiconductors. In the middle, or right after semiconductors, were components to computers. And we have semiconductor manufacturing equipment that is also important, as well as software. Look at the volume of the product here that is impacted by the ITA. We produce the foundational blocks to the digital infrastructure. We can get hit with tariffs at any one of these points, and the ITA wiped out most of the tariffs at those four points: the semiconductor equipment point, the semiconductor point, the printed circuit board point, and then the final product point. So again, huge drop in prices on ICTs and on semiconductors in particular, which go into, as has been said, into many, many products that benefit the economy. What does that do to our profile? As has been mentioned by, I think, Ambassador Shapiro, we're the number one export. It'd be surprising, I don't know if you knew that, above cars, above oil, above other things. And part of it is because of the lack of tariffs. And even though we have 3/4 of our manufacturing capacity in the U.S., so the ITA benefits our industry disproportionately, U.S. high-tech companies and U.S. semiconductor companies in particular. We are highly dependent on sales outside the U.S. to maintain high-paying jobs in the U.S. And this chart right here, in some ways, summarizes the whole thing. Because, let me just point out microprocessors, but it's the trend, as you know, the trend is similar in all ICT products. 40% drop when you take into account performance, price adjusted by quality, the price drop in semiconductors 40% per year. Computing power that cost $1 in 2000 now costs 1 cent. Can you imagine what tariffs at even just an average rate of 5% would have done to this innovation treadmill? So what you have here is you have what all the benefits that have been talked about today are promoted by the lack of tariffs. And this is a very telling chart portrays that. Thank you.
Well, thank you. That was great. And I actually think, even though everything that had been said, people did say unique things. So that was great. So let me open it up. We're going to adjourn precisely at 10:30, so we have about 20 minutes. If there are questions, let me start. If there are questions from anybody in the media, if you're not media, you can't reach me. Go ahead.
Sam Gilston with Washington Tariff and Trade Letter. Ambassador Shapiro, you mentioned that you're working on this at the TPP and in the APEC. Why isn't the U.S. just going in back to the ITA and getting the ITA members to reopen the ITA negotiations, as Ambassador Barshefsky did? And I know that the Bush administration opposed or was reluctant to get into those talks also. So maybe Ambassador Schwab might say why they didn't do it then. The European Union asked.
What we're doing is building support for this initiative. So how do you do that? You do that by talking to your trading partners. Furthermore, APEC is where the nucleus of the original ITA agreement was developed. So that's the natural first stop for us in terms of discussing this important initiative with our partners in APEC, which have been very supportive. And now, as I said, we're speaking bilaterally with others, also consulting with trading partners in Geneva. So what we're doing, if you take a step back and look, is building strong support. And there are a number of ways to do that, so we're using each of them.
Okay. Just press it once.
I think the situation in the Bush administration was different because we had filed the case against the EU. The EU wanted to negotiate, basically wanted us to pay a second time for them to eliminate tariffs that we considered to be illegal under the WTO. as part of renegotiation or expansion of the ITA. We had no intention of expanding the ITA and paying for a second time what we had paid for the first time. So it was just a different set of circumstances. We were always in favor of expanding, and we were on record saying we were in favor of expanding the ITA, but not in a negotiation that would have required us to pay a second time for what we had already paid for in 1996 negotiations.
Yeah, Jim Berger, Washington Trade Daily. Follow-up to that point, is there, Ambassador Shapiro, is there still a dichotomy between the U.S. view and the European Union view? I mean, they a couple years ago, they wanted to renegotiate the agreement and have an ITA, too. You're pretty explicit about expanding what we have, both by product and company. Are we on the same page, or...?
You'll have to ask the European Union that question as well, but from my perspective, we have the mandate now as a result of the existing agreement in order to expand product coverage. So that is what we are focused on. That is our highest priority. As I said a few minutes ago, it's important to lay the groundwork for this initiative. I think the time is right to do that now. But as with any initiative, in trade or any other area, you have to build support. And you do that often one by one. So that's the process that we're very much engaged in, to build the strongest possible support for what we think is a very important and useful and timely initiative.
Are you trying to build support within the EU?
Yeah, we are engaged in these discussions with, as I said, with our APEC partners, also with the European Union, and with other key trading partners.
Hello, my name is Carsten Schittek. I work in the European Commission. I come from Brussels. And actually, we had that building exercise yesterday with your colleagues in USTR. Thank you for allowing me to be here and to speak up. But just thanks, Stephen, for your report. Of course, all of us agree that the ITA is that successful, and the expansion will be a very important part for building that economic and boosting that economic growth that we all need. And Rob, actually, I have also your other study here, the gold standard. And I was reading here so that whilst the tariffs since the Uruguay round have gone down very importantly, actually, there, as you say here, at a practical level, many U.S. competitors responded by increasing, not reducing, an array of non-tariff barriers as part of concerted mercantilistic strategies. So, and I've seen also in your report, I mean, the very important part of the non-tariff barriers was not well addressed yet. I think there would probably be a second installment, and you'll come with these numbers later. But just to provide you some of the perspectives that we have in Europe, and frankly, I think that Ambassador Barshevsky was very visionary at the time that already in, at that moment, you included a mandate to do non-tariff barriers within the framework of the ITA agreement. Unfortunately, 15 years later, we have still not done anything. I mean, it was very small talk kind of discussions in a small room with technicians on non-tariff barriers. Nothing came out, not even transparency. So it is very important that we start addressing it 15 years later, because as industry, as you mentioned here, this is where the real problem is. Once you are in an area where you have zero tariffs, all the obstacles you have are non-tariff, of course, and that's where we are going to go. I don't want to be speaking too long and already have done so, but just to give you an indication of the evaluation of the economic benefit that we see in this, we have done our own studies, but I'm rather more quoting studies that are available publicly. The cost reduction, so the tariff equivalent that you are looking at if you would address non-tariff barriers, range from 6.5 to 70%. 6.5 to 70%. Of course, 70% is mana land. That's never going to happen. But just take the 6-point cost reduction, the lowest estimate. If we want to go for something moderate, if we want to be very quick in the conclusion of the agreement, let's go for something really moderate, 6%. In our estimate, any expansion, the tariff average is probably only around 3%.
Okay, great. Why don't we
thank
ask
for
responses to that, Ambassador?
Yeah, thank you. As I said, we are having discussions with the European Union We're very much aware that there are different views on this question of non-tariff barriers, both within the Commission and also among the member states. It's our view and the view of a large number of ITA participants that the current mandate does not include a negotiation over non-tariff barriers. The existing mandate, as was stated by the chair of the ITA committee, applies to expanding product coverage. That is what we want to do because it's so important, as we've discussed here today, and I think Greg Slides did a terrific job of representing that pictorially. They say a picture is worth a thousand words. Well, a slide can be worth perhaps 2,000. So we're very focused on the significant economic benefits and the relative ease of simply expanding product coverage, which is within the existing mandate. I do agree that non-tariff barriers are an important issue both in this sector and in many other sectors. And we have an ongoing dialogue with the European Union through the Transatlantic Economic Council and with other partners as well in terms of boosting our regulatory cooperation so that we can address these very important non-tariff barriers. But this is not the time or the place to do that. If we want to have a expansion in product coverage that is commercially meaningful and that can be done fairly quickly.
Anyone else?
Yeah. If I can make, just one comment. Europe wanted NTBs, Europe wanted NTBs included in ITA in 96, which I opposed at the time. And the compromise was that in the context of consultation, et cetera, NTBs could be discussed. Why did I oppose it at the time? Because had we included NTBs at the time, we'd still be negotiating the ITA. It's a very difficult issue to negotiate. And the point was to boost the internet economy, to boost growth. That was the focus of the agreement. And the statistics which we had, which as I said, now proved to be vastly understated, showed extraordinary gains to the global economy. We're in the same position now. So if you look at just the, you know, a one proposed product list, you would add almost $200 billion annually to global GDP. Now, in a time when you're still digging out from the 2008 synchronous decline in the economies of Europe, the US, and Japan, at a time when Europe is in very difficult straits, the US recovery is still somewhat nascent, hopefully getting stronger, but you know, you don't know. Japan's growth, which may be better now, but only masks absolute declines in the size of the Japanese economy over time. You don't leave $200 billion on the table to go after something that's going to take a very long time to do. So my own view is the agreement's really clear, the mandate's there. You take a look at the key actors in this space. There may be some changes in terms of critical mass. You sit them all down in a room, and you work out the product list, and you do the deal at zero. If you want to then embark on a separate negotiation on non-tariff barriers, I don't see any problem with that. But you don't hold up $200 billion annual increases in global GDP for that.
Greg?
Very briefly, just to back that up, there's a certain urgency here. I cut my remarks short, but we're developing what's called multi-chip integrated circuits to increase computing power, decrease the heat generation, you know, the use of energy, and it's putting more components on a single chip. They're not covered by the current ITA. We need those covered to continue that drop in price per performance, to continue the innovation treadmill. So we are so supportive of getting rid of NTBs, but we do not want to mess up the mandate that we now have to go forward and reap these benefits, that we can do it within a year.
Other, right back again. Yeah.
Yeah. Linda Bengetti, Emergency Committee for American Trade. Great presentations by all. Excellent report. Wanted to go back to Russia. I remember the day. It was a Veterans Day. Ambassador Schwab, when you did the bilateral deal with Russia on its entry into the WTO and first secured its agreement to join the ITA. Last year, we all saw Russia pull away from that commitment and appreciate the work, Ambassador Shapiro, that the Obama administration did to bring Russia back to the table and back from the brink so that in its final accession package that was re-included. Could you fill us in, Ambassador Shapiro, on where things are with Russia's implementation of that commitment? It is a big talking point for those of us who are on the Hill every day working to get PNTR with Russia completed as soon as possible. Couldn't agree with you more on the imperative of that. But anything you can add on Russia's own domestic implementation there?
Linda, let me first thank you and Cal and others in the private sector for their leadership in terms of working with us particularly hard last year to bring these conclusions that had started 18 years ago, even older than the ITA agreement, to a successful conclusion. And of course, all your work now to help explain to the American people what the benefits are of terminating Jackson-Vanik and the significant costs that our exporters will experience if we do not take that important step. With respect to ITA, you know how important this is to me and all of us at USTR and throughout the U.S. government. So we continue to push Russia, and they are in the process of getting their schedule together so that they can work with the Secretariat and take the formal steps that they need to in order to become a full participant.
We have time for maybe two more. We'll hear, I'll do them in order. So I'm, yes, sir, right here.
Thank you. I'm Robin Rourke with the Commerce Department's International Trade Administration. Thank you to the panel, and it's great to see three U.S. trade representatives here. ITA, of course, has been a partner all along with the original Information Technology Agreement, and we continue to work with our colleagues at USTR on the expansion. I wanted to ask a question related to expansion of membership. Ambassador Shapiro, you noted the Russian accession, but there's one outlier among the BRICS, Brazil. And so I wonder, in light of President Rousseff's upcoming visit, if you care to comment on the prospects for bringing Brazil into the agreement.
You work for the U.S. government?
I don't know what the answer is, but...
I'm really glad you mentioned Brazil, because I wanted to tell you all that this week, it was Tuesday, all of 2 days ago, I chaired the first meeting of the commission with Brazil that we established under the ATEC, the Agreement on Trade and Economic Cooperation, that we signed when the president was in Brasilia last March. So just getting that agreement together and taking our relationship to the next level was a big step, and we were very pleased to have hosted the committee, the commission's meeting this week. And of course, I just want all you to know, I raised ITA with Brazil, and I said, I know you're not a party, I don't understand it, but just be on notice that I think this is something very important for you to consider doing, and I'm going to come back to you again and again in order to work with you to fully appreciate the benefits and see you come on board. So they do, they're not ready. Don't put that on the record, but my view, they're not ready yet, but we will continue to work with them in order to persuade them, as you can put on the record, just persuade them of the many benefits to their joining.
Good, thank you.
Thanks for raising that.
Yeah, sure.
Hi, my name is Roy Michael. I'm with Malaysia Chamber of Commerce. I have two questions, short ones. First question is, what sort of programs that you have, specific programs that you have, undertaken to promote and expand ITA? And secondly, with the ongoing discussion on rare earth, what does that have impact on ITA?
I didn't hear the second question.
The ongoing discussion on rare earth.
Oh, rare earth.
And how does it impact on ITA?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, we talked about Russia, I mentioned Colombia, I mentioned TPP partners. This is an increasingly large group of countries that are going to have to join. I didn't mention Chile, which is an existing free trade partner. but it's an older agreement, so it was before we put in the ITA clause. I was down in Chile not too long ago, and again, I pressed my counterparts to join, and I think they're considering it. Again, don't put that last part about they're considering on the record. I never like to talk for other countries, but I want to be able to share with you what my impressions are. So we are indeed pressing Chile and others. Mexico, for example, is not a member. I've raised this with my counterpart several times. And of course, if they do join TPP, that will be part of their obligation. Your question about rare earths is a very good one. You all may have seen the news yesterday that we have requested consultations with China over the export restraints and other mechanisms they use to artificially restrict the availability of rare earths for exports. Many of these products are obviously critical inputs to semiconductors and many of our technology products and those of our trading partners. We were joined, of course, in this effort by Japan and by the European Union. Good example of the close cooperation that we do have with Europe on most issues and the kind of cooperation that we always strive for in terms of trying to ensure that not only is the ITA being upheld, but also that WTO obligations are being fully implemented.
Great, thank you. So I promised we'd get out by 10:30. I want to do a couple quick things. I want to, first of all, thank my colleague Stephen Azell for really yeoman's work on this study and documenting and real numbers. Also, Ambassador Shapiro for taking time out of her busy schedule to join us, and our other two ambassadors, and also Greg, and of course, thank you. So appreciate it, and hopefully we'll have an event next year that'll say, wow, we did this.
One year.
I'll have some Irish beer.